Hi, and good afternoon, good morning to all of you. Myself, Kinjal Vora, I am a marketing head at Drona HQ, and I would like to extend a warm welcome to each of you, our dynamic divas out here on this Women's Day, to come and share with us a journey that you have been through in the technology industry. Thank you for gracefully accepting my invitation and, you know, come here and share with all the young women who are out there who aim and plan to have a career in tech. Mridvika is a negotiator. Her day job is to negotiate with clients, job seekers, boss, and everyone else in between. And her night job is to negotiate with her 8-year-old twin boys, who are her most difficult stakeholders to work with. Mridvika has spent her career of 15 years across IT services, consulting, financial services clients, edtech, and nonprofit fundraising in India and US. Prior to Shortlist, she was Director of Strategic Partnerships at Mindseed, an edtech startup, where she supported founders on raising Series A fundraise and led internal operations. She has spent 5 years at Teach for India, where she was an integral part of its scale-up and led the national fundraising team. She was a senior consultant at Ernst & Young Financial Services Office in New York, advising senior secondary mortgage industry clients. Mridvika has a bachelor's degree in computer science from Mumbai University and master's in information systems from Cali School of Business, Indiana University. Very warm welcome to you, Mridvika. Hi, how are you doing?
And thank you so much, Kinjal, for that interesting introduction. I'm very glad to be spending my Saturday afternoon talking to all you lovely ladies and sharing my journey. Thank you so much.
Good. Mridvika, just one question to start off with. How has the pandemic affected recruitment and staffing, and how do you see the business blooming up today?
Yeah, through the pandemic, we've seen the ups and lows, you know, through the last year. When we just got hit by pandemic, you know, the first 2 months were really brutal because the world went on hiring freeze. And if the world goes on a hiring freeze, a recruitment and a search business essentially, you know, comes to a standstill. However, we were able to survive because we had a portfolio of clients that were distributed across industries and sectors. So we had clients in education space, we had clients in nonprofit space. So that allowed us to float along. And I think around July, people realized this is how the world is going to be for the next foreseeable future. And we started receiving, you know, the hiring mandates again. And since then, it's been no looking back. I think we've not been as busy as we were before the pandemic. So so all in all, it's been good. You know, it was unfortunate for the job seekers because, as you know, a lot of them were affected and had lost their jobs. But things are looking up, and I think we are on path to recovery now.
From her role as a consultant at ENY and then fundraising for tech, Teach for India. Mridvika, do you want to share your story?
Sure. Thanks, Kinjal. So me becoming a computer engineer was almost like a flip of a coin because so I come from a family of doctors. So, you know, in the times at least then, I think all of us were growing up, you know, if it was not for parents telling you what to do, it was like what you looked around people choosing. So people were either becoming doctors or engineer, and I was too scared to, you know, go into the field of medicine. So I said, okay, engineering seems to be another respectable option to take. That's how, you know, I flipped the coin and took engineering. And I did my engineering from Mumbai University, Thadumal Shahani Engineering College, and got campus recruited by an IT services firm called Hexaware Technologies. I was back in the day coding and testing, gathering requirements on mainframes and COBOL and JCL platform for a telecommunications client sitting in the US. So I think working in engineering for those 2 years probably just left me wondering how are these decisions made to change a to bring about a change in a technology system. What prompts the business to sort of like, you know, get the technology to sort of make these changes. So I was keen to sort of understand how business decisions are made, which is why I wanted to pursue my master's in information systems. So I went to the US, did my post-graduation from a business school, and then got recruited by Ernst & Young. And as I joined Ernst & Young, I was working as a technology consultant, primarily advising secondary mortgage industry clients and financial services clients when two banks would merge, what systems have to stay, what how the integration has to take place, what systems have to get retired. And I enjoyed all of that. And then soon, I started missing home and wanted to come back to India. One of the reasons I think I had all the opportunities that I got, you know, as I worked in the initial years of my life was primarily thanks to the kind of education that opportunities that I had gotten. Therefore, I wanted to work in the social impact sector that was equalizing access to education for all. And that's how I came across Teach for India, a nonprofit organization. And I knew I couldn't be a teacher in a classroom because, you know, it requires immense patience to do that. So I was looking for roles within the nonprofit sector that allowed me to carry forward whatever I had learned over the years. So my role at Teach for India was that of a development manager, a fundraising manager, that allowed me to sort of draw parallels with what I was doing in consulting. So in consulting, I was managing clients and interfacing with them on a day-to-day basis. In a fundraising role at a nonprofit, I was dealing with donors, grant makers, high net worth individuals. Over there, also I was doing a lot of proposal writing. In Teach for India, also I was doing a lot of grant writing and creating those you know, donor proposals. And so there were a lot of parallels that I could draw in terms of the work that I was doing that made me successful in my role at Teach for India. And after having done that for about 5 years, I realized that I was again itching for a startup stint wanted to learn how fundraising essentially happens for edtech companies. And so I joined this edtech company called Mindseed that was at the time raising their Series A fundraise. So at Teach for India, while I got the opportunity to raise funds from international philanthropies, foundations, high net worth individuals, at Mindseed I was able to assist and support the founders in raising their Series A fundraise from private equity and venture capital firms. And that was a great experience. And then, the role became a little internal focused, where I was managing internal operations with HR, finance, school operations reporting into me. And I wanted to have a component in my role that had external stakeholder management experience, which is why, I was looking for another role. And shortlist happened at that time. And what drew me to shortlist was obviously the people that were running it, the global exposure that I would get. But at the same time, the overall vision of the organization was, how do we match potential with the opportunities or jobs that they love doing? So we've all seen, sometimes the companies they hire based on pedigree on the resume, or blue chip companies on the resume, as opposed to hiring for potential. And so that was the vision that resonated with me, because I've sort of had my own winding journey across different sectors, and the opportunities that I got at every single place brought me to the place where I am today. So here I am working with Shortlist. I manage their global search business, today. We have presence in India and in Africa, and I'm happy to be sharing more about you know, how we navigate through this. Thanks, Kinya.
Very interesting, very vast range of experience from COBOL programming all the way back to Series A fundraising and to leading a search profile for the shortlist. Very interesting. Do you think you have learned on the job, or you have kind of personally taken an effort to keep yourself abreast with what is happening and where you want to move next?
Yeah. So I think most of my learning has happened on the job. But while you are in a specific job, given I told you about my journey, it was always very helpful to, keep learning about the industry trends while you were sort of entering something new. So every single job that I have taken up, it has been additive to my skill set. So I was an engineer, so I understood how systems talk to each other, how data flows between different systems. And so when I was consulting, it allowed me to sort of gather a lot more external facing skills, like negotiating with the clients, influencing them, their decision making, how to present a proposal or make a presentation to a wider audience. And then when I came to Teach for India, it allowed me to sort of gather skills like networking and making sure that you are connected with the high net worth individuals who you can reach out to when you are raising funds. And then in my current role, for the last 5 years, I've been learning ropes of how to manage a P&L, to to managing the marketing and the HR and the finance side of things. So every single sort of role has allowed me to learn a different facet or functional area of the business, and I'm extremely grateful for that. So
talking about some risks and failures, would you like to share any such incident which has shaped your career right now, the way you are at your present?
Yeah, I think there is a running joke in my house, which my mother always says that I don't know, what you do on a day-to-day basis, because, from my education in engineering to what I'm doing now in the recruitment space, it's been a series of risks. And each of the risks or each of the turning points have actually been extremely rewarding for me, because every role change has allowed me to gather knowledge about that specific field and that sector, and build relationships that have always stayed with me, whether I was in that particular role or job or not. So in terms of rewards, while you are taking a risk, I think my biggest reward has been the relationships that I've carried along, from one role to the other.
How do you reconcile the key IT initiatives with the bottom line?
Yeah, so I think, for a lot of us, we've seen the importance of IT systems, IT processes, how they bring about efficiency, and how they sort of, at the end of the day, help us reduce cost, reduce the man hours that are required to do a certain job. And when you are able to reduce the cost, and when you are able to reduce the time taken to achieve efficiency, the bottom line obviously sort of gets impacted, because then you are able to sort of have cost savings across different facets on your budget. So I think investment in IT processes and IT systems at the right stage of an organization is extremely critical. And I have seen that happening in organizations when I was consulting them, and then being on the other side of the table as an entrepreneur, as working in startups, I have implemented them as well to sort of achieve the impact on the bottom line. So
what has been the most profound executive decision you have ever made, Mritika?
I think being in a leadership position, you're taking multiple decisions through the day, but I think that the deepest one that has had impact on me has been through the pandemic, where you know, as a startup, you could go in either direction when it comes to preserving the company or sort of like, you know, keeping everyone on the ship. And I think one of the executive decisions that I did take that actually gave us a lot of good results, you know, as quarter three picked up, was I was able to sort of retain every single person on the team despite being a recruitment business. And so this decision could have gone either way, right? Like one could have decided to keep the entire team intact without having to let anyone go, and you know, things would have not picked up, and the business would have gone down south. But I think I took the chance and I took the gamble to sort of keep the team on board, and we saw that the entire team came together, you know, almost as a unit to say we have to see ourselves through this this storm on the other side of it, with every single one of us being on the ship. So I think that was the most profound decision I've taken in the recent times. I think one last piece that I would add, which has helped me constantly, is be in the front row of your career, like all the time, which means that, you know, you have to be the one to spot growth opportunities when they present themselves, because they are the ones that will be, you know, that will shape your career. They will, and you will know that they are the key learning opportunities, because you will feel uncomfortable when they would be presented in front of you. And your initial impulse would be that maybe you're not ready. But one thing that I've known is that growth and comfort, they never coexist. They somehow, you know, always are at odds. So always take on new challenges and say more yeses than no's in your career.
Yeah. On that concluding note, what we agree, technology isn't scary. We all started with being a programmer or a non-programmer, software engineer, developer, and we have evolved into a into a leadership roles, or into roles where we are enabling businesses and solving day-to-day problems with technology. Being a woman in tech do not have to be confined by those definitions or profiles of technology. You can grow, evolve, and learn from the business aspect as well. To have a successful and satisfying career, I think the prerequisites are eagerness to solve problems and have a confident headspace. Just pick up those opportunities, try and gain things, pull up your socks, do your decisions every day, have the grit to follow it. And knowing the critical business pain areas and solving it with computational thinking are the just key elements that will help women have their journey through a tech industry or a tech career. And that's exactly the message that Drona HQ is giving: coding or no coding, achieve digital solutions for your organization at speed. I think that's the end of, I'll wrap it up, end of a wonderful panel. I think we took way too much time for your discussion, and I would love to thank you once again for coming up, sharing your experiences, sharing your profound knowledge that you have gained over years. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Kinjal, for inviting me, and it's been wonderful spending time on a Saturday afternoon with all of you. Thank you so much.